when these figures and the data what you have analyzed in the form of statistics, you record. Okay, so data in the form of records also you present. Then again, facts, all the facts what you collect, all the information what you collect through questionnaire, through interview, through survey, these all are facts, right? So data can be of any type. It could be a statistics, it could be a numbers, information, figures, records and facts. So this is the most basic and important thing what everyone has to understand. So but then what does Webb says about data? It is a collection of facts from which conclusions may be drawn. Okay, that is a statistical data. Then it is a term that means groups of information that we represent. It could be in the form of qualitative or quantitative attributes of a variable. Or different set of variables. So the data or the information what you collect for through these attributes is your data. Then next thing, the data is information that has been organized and has been categorized for a predetermined purpose. Any research goals you do, it will have a predetermined purpose. You will have your research question in place, you will have your hypothesis that you that what you will test. So any information that you are collecting is having a purpose, is has been organized. So all the data collected is relevant to your purpose. Okay, you will not collect any data which is irrelevant. Okay, then in computer science, data is anything in the form suitable for use with a computer. That is in statistics what you use, in Excel sheet what data you enter is in the form of a computer only, right? Then we have data are the smallest units of measure. The word is technically the plural of datum, but often used as a singular. See girls, data is a plural form for datum, but usually what we do, we consider data as a singular form only. So this is what Webb says about data. Then we have two types of data, that is primary and secondary. Primary data is what? That is collected by researcher first hand. If you are conducting any research, okay, you do your thesis, you do your dissertation, what data you collect through survey, through interview, that is a primary data that demands efforts and resources, right? You have to go to each of your respondent. Okay, bhai, humko ye questionnaire fill karke de do. I have few questions I want to ask you. Okay, and also it depends upon the researcher's ability and clarity of purpose. If you are clear about your hypothesis, if you are clear about your research question, your review of literature is in place properly, then it is your ability, your clarity, the way you collect your primary data. Then further we have secondary data that is collected by someone else, but it is used by researcher second hand. Your review of literature, what you do, you use data collected and reviewed and analyzed by other researchers and you use that as your review. You discuss your data using secondary data, right? It is cheaper and quicker. There are theses also, students. We are from science background, so we have to collect data through primary data. But when you see the literature, when you see the psychology, some part of psychology, there they have to do secondary research only. Hindi literature, okay, English literature, there the data collected is secondary data only. Their dissertation is fully, completely based on secondary data. Okay, in secondary data, you require less resources. It has to be a certain accuracy of content, but apart from being cheaper, apart from using less resources, it has to have accuracy of content. The time, sources, purpose, methods, adequacy, and credibility all have to be a certain accurately and properly. Okay, girls, any doubts? You can just write on chat. When I finish my presentation, I'll see on the chat. Okay. Then, girls, importance of data collection. Why we do data collection? What is the need for data collection? Integrity of the research. Integrity of the research, it is a key reason for collecting the data, be it through qualitative method or any quantitative method. This is to ensure the integrity of the research question that is included, and it has to be maintained. So that you are doing any research or you are doing any data collection, so the integrity of the research is completely dependent on your research question or hypothesis. Then reduce the likelihood of errors. This is the correct use of approach of data collection that reduce the likelihood of errors that is consistent with the results. In any, the method what you follow in a data collection, girls, it has to be error free. The questionnaire what you set, the interview plan what you do, the survey profile what you make, for focus group discussion what points have you planned, everything has to be relevant and related to your research question. So integrity of the research has been placed in the top because all the other points will help to keep your integrity intact. Okay, then we have decision making. It is to minimize the risk of errors in decision making. It is important that accurate data is collected so that the researcher doesn't make uninformed decisions. Again, this is relevant to your research question. How, if your research question is saying something and your tools is saying something else, will it be connected? Will it be relevant? No. So your decision making will depend upon the research question and what decision you make with respect to the tools or with respect to the type of data what you collect will help to reduce the errors as well. Okay, then save cost and time. Data collection saves the researcher time and funds that would otherwise be misspent without a deeper understanding of the topic or any subject matter. So if you have thoroughly understood your topic, you have done your review properly, you have written important points, important thing what you want to collect, and what data is required for which question, which hypothesis, that will help you save time as well as your cost. Okay, then to support a need for a new idea, change and or innovation. So we collect data to prove the need for a change in the norm or the introduction of any new information that will be widely accepted. What any research what we do has to be generalized to the entire population, right? So we want our analysis or the result what we obtained has to be accepted throughout the population. It is important to collect data as evidence to support these claims. Got it, girls? The importance of data collection. Then we have, what are the different steps for data collection? First, we have to construct the tools for data collection. Okay, so it is very important to decide the tools for data collection because why? Research is carried out in different ways and for different purpose. Okay, no single research is having common purpose. Okay, data collection tools has to refer to the devices or instruments that are used to collect the data. We have different tools such as paper questionnaire or computer assistant interviewing system. Then we have case studies, checklist, interviews, observation, and sometimes surveys or questionnaires or tools that are used to collect data. We'll go ahead in detail further. Then the main objective behind data collection is to capture quality evidence that allows the analysis to lead to the formulation of convincing and credible answers to the questions that have been posed. From beginning, I'm saying whatever data we are collecting is answering to your research questions. We have to convince our readers that whatever answers we have collected through our data and whatever analysis we have done and whatever interpretation we have obtained is credible to our research question and hypothesis. So for that, we have to construct the tools for data collection. And after that, we have to decide about the different techniques of data collection. Tools we have decided. Then for that tools, what different techniques we have to use to collect data, that is also important. Then after your techniques are decided, you have to test your tool and the technique by pilot study or pre-testing of tool. This is the girl's most important point that you can note down, and I'll share the PPT also. You have to test the tool by pilot study or pre-testing of tool. Any questionnaire, any interview questionnaire, interview questions you form, you have to pre-test in a small sample, and then you have to verify, you have to do your some reliability test of the questionnaire, and then only you can go ahead for a entire sample. Okay, but your pre-testing and a pilot study sample has to be different from your main study sample. This thing you have to keep in mind. When I did my PhD, I was conducting survey in slums, okay? In Bombay slums only, I did in Bombay only. So my pilot study was done on another slum area where I took around 50 mothers. I was doing study on mothers. I did questionnaire on 50 mothers. I analyzed my questionnaire. Are all my questions giving the answers what is relevant to my research question? I have to check, okay? If any question, when I asked the person, the subject, whether they are understanding the question and they are answering in the same way, what is relevant to my research question? We have to check each and every question, and then a reliability analysis has been done. And then on that reliability, you can change or tweak your questions in that way that you get a correct information what you require. After a pre-testing, after a pilot study, you have to finalize your tool or technique for your data collection. Then you have to ascertain the reliability and validity of tools to be used for data collection. As I said, during a pilot study only, you will collect the data, you will have all the information from a subsample, and then this reliability and validity is been conducted on that data. Then you can actually start your collection of data for your thesis. Got it? Then we have, what are the different tools and techniques? For tools, we have questionnaire, interview schedule, observation schedule, scales, test, inventory and checklist, or sociogram and sociometry. This is a new thing introduced, girls, sociogram and sociometry. This is to identify individual and the sociogram. Because of social media has been increasing in current scenario, this has been a new tool wherein you can tap your subjects or respondents through different social media also. Then techniques used for these tools are questioning, that is, it could be a written questionnaire or it could be an oral questionnaire in the form of interview. Interview can be face-to-face, telephonic, electronic, or through net, or group interview or video. Then we have observation technique, then we have projective techniques, and then we have panel methods. It could be through diary, checklist, or logs, and etc. Another thing is combination research, where more than two techniques or more than one techniques are used. This encompasses the use of innovative methods to enhance the participation to both individual and groups. Okay. Also, when we see further, there are primary and secondary data category also. It is in primary category, we have combination of interview and focus group. So we are using two techniques. Interview and focus group for collection of qualitative data, and this is the key to address important issues, girls. So the best collection technique to be used is combination technique only. Whenever you do your research, you also can focus on questionnaire and interview. When you ask the questionnaire, your respondent fills, okay, after that you can have some questions to ask them. Then you can use observation technique also. When I did my research, I went to slums. Okay, I was observing the children also, who are my respondents. And then while filling my checklist or questionnaire, the observation points what I mentioned, that also helped me out. Okay, so combination research is the best tool. The combination method involves two or more data collection methods. For example, as I said, interview as well as questionnaire, or a combination of semi-structured telephone interview and focus groups. These are the best tools. Then we have factors influencing decision about data collection tool, technique, or method. As we discussed earlier, decision making is an important thing. So what are the factors which will help you to decide on the data collection tool? Scale and magnitude of the study. What kind of data you want to collect for your purpose, research purpose, or research question. So the scale, whether your subject size will be 30 or more than 30, or if you are doing any, because of you all are clinical nutrition students, so I think all your data will be connected to human contact only. Being a from food science and nutrition, We can also do study on testing of, see, I want to do nutritional content of mangoes, right? So in that case, the data collection tool will be completely different. But in your case, where humans are involved, so the scale and magnitude of the study, number of samples, number of subjects you want to tackle, and then what kind of data you want to collect, whether you have to see the hospital, if you're collecting data through any hospitals, what are the hospital records you want to see, if you want to interview the doctors also, the nurses also, the patients also. So all these things you have to decide beforehand, before selecting your data collection tool. Then characteristics of the respondents, how many males, how many females, any tentative idea you have to decide before collecting the tool. Okay, what age group you want to select. Okay, then any kind of study if you do for diabetes, your characteristics of respondents will also depend on your research question. Okay, then unit of inquiry and analysis, what kind of inquiry or analysis you want to do, what kind of analysis you want to proceed, statistical analysis you want to proceed, this will depend on what kind of data you are collecting. Then availability of resources, are you getting any funds for your study, so that will depend what kind of collection tool you want to do. Then time, human, technical and competence. I'll tell you my experience for PhD girls. I did a study on nutrition education and supplementation, because I thought that I want to give supplements to young children, because if I'm taking that data, it was my responsibility to give them something. My guide told me, I worked on the Dr. DP. She told me that, Neha, this will be a costly thing. I worked hard, I got a scholarship from ICSSR, and then I did my education modules also I prepared, and then food and food supplementation also I developed a supplement. I developed three supplements, then I did sensory evaluation study, and then I decided on one supplement to distribute to my patient, my subjects. Okay, so your data collection tool is dependent on the resources what you have, right? Then we have field conditions. Wherever you are going to collect your data, what are the conditions over there? Subject under the study, again this is relevant, related to your respondents only. Then we have expected outcome, the data collection tools what you are going to use, what kind of data you will get back, that also you have to foresee and you have to think over it before deciding. That is where your pilot study is going to help you girls. Okay, then we have degree of precision or reliability is also required. This also will come to you'll come to know when you'll do your pilot study. Got it, girls? Then we have primary data collection. As I said, what are the different ways? In-person surveys you can do. This is done to gain general answers to your basic questions. Then we have direct observation, when the research is directly involved with the study group. As I said, when I was doing my dissertation, I used to go monthly, because mine was a follow-up study, and I used to observe students also, my subjects also, and then I used to ask questions relevant to that, to the to mothers. Then we have interviews. It is used to gain more in-depth answers to your complex questions. Then girls, we have focus group discussions. This is certain sample groups are asked their opinion about a certain subject or theory. See, if you have around 50 subjects, you can divide them into two groups or three groups, and then you can have a focus group discussion on any topic. You can ask them and ask their opinions about that, and then you can write on your points so that you can discuss in your discussion. Then primary data collection tools, they allow for a true measurement of accuracy and let the researcher obtain any unspoken observations about the participants while conducting research. So in this, anything what the respondent doesn't tell you, you can obtain your unspoken observation while conducting your research. For example, we can say socioeconomic surveys, studies related to rural or tribal communities, nursing research, hospital management studies, knowledge awareness, practice studies, etc. In these, all your observation along with interview is going to help you to collect data. Then we have secondary data collection. We can do this collection through postal mail, electronic mail, web-based surveys, and telephone. And it is done when very large group of population is required. When you're this if or any kind of survey you are doing, then this tool is required and it is essential. When personal contact is not possible for the researcher to collect the data, okay? Because now you can say in COVID times, this tool is going to help you girls. You can increase your population size and then through surveys, you can Google form pay survey, you can just share to many people and you can expect around 60 to 70% of people will respond to you with your answers. Okay, so you can focus on this kind of tool while doing your research, which is I think you'll start your data collection and your research topic right away, right? So this thing you can see Google form pe survey pe apna form tayar kar lo, then get it checked through your guide, and then you can share through LinkedIn, through Gmail, and through Facebook, and then you get the answers, and then you can collect that, you can analyze your data. For example, institutional survey, organizational research. So for these, secondary data collection is important. Other sources of secondary data, what you can use are books, records, then newspapers, biographies, then published censuses or other statistical data, NFHS data or any census data, then data archives or internet articles, that is research articles by research articles published by other researchers. And then you can check other databases also, right? So here you'll get your other secondary data information. Through this postal mail, electronic mail, your questionnaire or your survey form can be answered. But to justify what you have collected, you need other sources, what I have said just now, other research paper, database, statistical data. These will help you to discuss what you have, the data you have collected. Because you have to prove the data what you have collected are relevant to your research questions, right? So for these, you will require secondary data only. Now, girls, in my presentation further, I will discuss these different tools for data collection. I will tell about what are the characteristics, what are the pros and cons of questionnaire, interview, schedule, observation techniques, and rating scales. Okay, first we will go to questionnaire. It is a list of questions that is related to one topic. It is easy to prepare and to administer, right? As I said earlier also, you can prepare questionnaire relevant to your research question. And in this questionnaire, girls, you can do cross questioning also. You can have some questions asked in different ways. Okay, then there are some quotes on questionnaire. A questionnaire is a systematic compilation of questions that are submitted to a sampling of population from which information is desired. This is a kind of definition for a questionnaire given by Barr, Davis, and Johnson. Then Goody and Hall has also defined questionnaire in general. It is the word questionnaire refers to a device for securing answers to questions by using a form which the respondent fills in himself. Again, questionnaire can be filled by the respondent himself, or when you ask the questions from your questionnaire, then it will be a kind of a questionnaire or interview, right? Then it is a form prepared and distributed to secure responses. It is a device for securing answers to questions using a form which the respondent filled by himself. Again, what Good and Hall has said, again, it has been re-emphasized. Then we have characteristics of good health. It deals with an important or significant topic. Again, relevant to your research question and hypothesis, all the questions has to be important and directly linked to your topic. Then its significance is carefully stated on the questionnaire itself or on its covering letter. Anytime you prepare a questionnaire, girls, you have to have a brief introduction. Why are you taking this questionnaire? What data you want to collect through this questionnaire? And most importantly, you have to take the consent of your questionnaire that yes, they give their consent to participate in a study and they will provide all true information. So this kind of consent you have to take. So this has to be stated previously in your questionnaire in a covering letter and all the objectives of your questionnaire. So again, the objectives, what data will come out of the questionnaire in the form of objective, you have to mention right before your question start. Then it seeks only that data which cannot be obtained from the resources like books, reports, and records. Respondents' data will not be available in books, reports, and records, right? So you have to ask questions relevant to your research hypothesis and relevant to the characteristics of the respondents. Okay, so first part of the questionnaire will be dealing with your demographic data, that is characteristic of the respondent, and then you can start with your research hypothesis, what kind of questions are related to that. It is as short as possible, only long enough to get the essential data. What this sentence means, girls? Short as soon as possible, matlab all questions will not be answers will not be too lengthy. You can have a multiple choice questions, okay, so that you have your answers ready, only you want a respondent to tick. And long enough, you can include many questions, but see to it that it doesn't take that long time also to fill the questionnaire. Then it is attractive in appearance, nearly arranged and clearly duplicated or printed. If you have all questions with the predefined answers, only the respondent has to tick the answer, then it has be, it is clear, neatly arranged and clearly duplicated, and it, the data will be easily entered in your Excel sheet. Directions are clear and complete. Important terms are clarified. Okay, when your objectives and your purpose of the questionnaire has been clearly defined, then there is less difficulty for the respondent to fill the questionnaire. And when your respondents are illiterate, then it's your duty to make them understand about the purpose and the objective, and then ask the question in their local language. The questions are objective with no clues, hints or suggestions. You cannot give open-ended question that, okay, they can write essays and stories out of for that question, okay? So the objective should be clear, and there will be no clues or hints or any suggestions what they have to write. They shouldn't make out your purpose and intention for that questionnaire, okay? It has to be clear, and their viewpoint we have to know. Aise biased answers nahi chahiye hume, right? Then questions are presented in order from simple to complex. All the simple questions have to be placed first, and then you can go beyond to complex questions. Double negatives, adverbs, and descriptive adjectives are avoided. What we say, the two questions in a clubbed together cannot be used, right? So that the respondents get confused. So avoid confusion. Double-barreled questions again, or putting two questions in one question, are also avoided. Is the same thing. Then the questions carry adequate number of alternatives. As I said, you can have alternatives, predefined alternatives, so that you get your answers. You know, okay, I'll get either this answer or this answer or this answer. Okay, and no other answer apart from these you will get. So you have, that is, you have your answers relevant to your topic only. Then it is easy to tabulate, summarize, and interpret. When you have the predefined alternatives, then the answers also, it's very predefined. You can easily tabulate your answer sheet. Then you can summarize it and analyze it and then interpret it, right? Then girls, we have merits and demerits of questionnaire. Why questionnaire is good? It is a very economical, time-saving process. Once you prepare a questionnaire, and if you, all your subjects you know are literate, educated, you can use a secondary data technique, right? Then it covers the research in wide area. It's very suitable for special type of responses, and it is more reliable in special cases. Okay, then what are the disadvantages? There are disadvantages for questionnaire also. Through this, we get only limited responses. As we said, a good questionnaire has predefined alternatives, so you get limited responses. Okay, then lack of personal contact, greater possibility of wrong answers, chances of receiving incomplete responses are more because you have closed-ended questions. Sometimes answers may be illegible. Okay, what answers they have given, you cannot interpret it properly, or you cannot conclude it. It may be useless in many problems. Not all type of research problems a questionnaire is used. Okay, so you have to think clearly and properly about the research question and the purpose of your study, and then you can decide on your tool. Then we go on to interview. Okay, and interview, it is a rapport which has been developed. We have to establish between the interviewee and interviewer, right? Not only it is a physical distance, but then annihilated the social and cultural barriers also removed. Okay, because it's face to face you do, or through telephoning you have a contact, you have a conversation with your interviewee, right? So all your barriers are removed, and a free mutual flow of ideas to and fro takes place, right? When I say and I'm talking to you, you also will speak something, and then it is exchange of ideas. Both create their respective impression upon each other, right? The interview brings them both on the same level, and an emotional attachment supervenes between them. So interview is a two-way method that permits an exchange of ideas and information. Good and Hart defines interview as it is fundamentally a process of social interaction. Then P.V. Young defines interview, it may be regarded as a systematic method by which a person enters more or less imaginatively into the inner life of a comparative stranger, right? The interviewer doesn't know the interviewee, so he has to enter into his life to get details about the questions relevant to his research. Okay, then what is the difference between questionnaire and interview? In interview also there are set of questions. In questionnaire method also there are set of questions. So in questionnaire method, data is gathered indirectly, but in interview method it is gathered directly. There is no face-to-face contact between the two when you use questionnaire method, but there is a face-to-face contact between interviewer and interviewee. Interviewer for questionnaire method should have the general knowledge of the topic, but for interview a skillful interviewer is needed, right? You should know everything about your research, then only you can ask. Because in interview you have a preset or defined questions, but while asking and while talking there are other information also what you will come across, so you have to we have to take note of that also. So a skillful interviewer is needed. Interviewer will hesitate to write it in questionnaire method, but while using interview as a method, some confidential information can also be obtained. You can observe and write, you can ask, you can tweak your questions in such a way that some other information also what is important for your research you will come across, and you can ask in another simple way so that the interviewee is not feeling ashamed of, and he or she can respond. Then in questionnaire method we get written information only, but in interview we get written as well as oral, both type of information. What it goes, the difference between the questionnaire and the interview method. Then we have characteristics of an interview. The interviewer can probe into casual factors, determine the attitudes, discover the origin of problem, right? Because interview we have face-to-face contact, then it's appropriate to deal with young children, illiterate person, as I said, when you're using questionnaire method also, but your respondent are illiterate, then the interview method is used. It can make cross-questioning possible, right? It helps the investigator to gain an impression of the person concerned, because you are clearing all your social and cultural barriers, and when you are an interviewer and you interview, so the impression of the person is also important, okay? And you have to gain confidence while you interview. I was an interviewer and I went through Bandra slums, Dahisar slums, okay? Then at that time I was not a research associate or researcher for them. I was a individual among them, okay? Unke saath baithke baate karna, unke saath unke bachcho ki sunna, sab kuch. So this had to be done when you are doing any research, and when you want data and you want them to give your true data, okay? Then it can deal with delicate, confidential and even intimate topics, okay? As I said, in interview you can have that information also that is confidential. It has flexibility. Then sincerity, frankness, truthfulness and insight of the interviewee can be better judged through cross-questioning. it gives no chance for respondent to modify his earlier answer, right? It is applicable in survey method, but it is also applicable in historical, experimental, case studies and clinical studies, right? Then what are the merits and demerits of interview? What are the merits? Direct research, deep research. Okay, you can go in depth when you are asking questions. Knowledge of past and future, knowledge of special features, mutual encouragement is also possible. Supra observation is possible. You can talk to interviewer, interviewee. You can observe his reactions. You can observe the surroundings as well. Then that is supra observation. Knowledge of historical and emotional causes. Then examination of the known data. All these are the merits and importance of using interview as a data collection tool. Then we have demerits. May provide misleading information. Sometimes some respondents are very smart. They will not show the real reaction or the real answers. Okay, you cannot make out through their reaction also what are they trying to say. So they can mislead you. Defects due to interviewing. Low level of intelligence or maybe emotionally unbalanced. Result may be affected due to prejudices of interviewer. Agar mere dimag mein kuch hai and I will ask question accordingly. मेरे को वही आंसर सुनना है. सो इट्स लाइक जो मुझे सुनना है मुझे वही सुनना है. सो आई विल नॉट डिफरेंशिएट बिटवीन व्हाट द इंटरव्यूई इज आंसरिंग. ओके, सो ऑल द इंटरव्यूअर्स प्रेजुडाइजेस आर आल्सो इंपॉर्टेंट व्हाट दे थिंक. रिजल्ट मे बी अफेक्टेड ड्यू टू द डिफरेंस इन द मेंटल आउटलुक ऑफ इंटरव्यूई एंड इंटरव्यूअर. व्हेन यू आर गोइंग, एट व्हाट टाइम यू आर गोइंग एंड व्हाट इज द सिचुएशन ऑफ द इंटरव्यूई, एवरीथिंग मैटर्स. सो यू हैव टू keep that also in mind. One sided and incomplete research. Okay, art rather than science. It is a art of asking questions, art of interviewing. So rather than science we can say it is interviewing is an art. Then we have schedule. This is the third type of tool. When a researcher is using a set of questionnaires for interview purpose, it is known as schedule. Again, when a questionnaire is used but you are taking answers by asking them through interview, it is known as schedule. Okay, as a matter of fact, when we say success is the use of schedule, it is largely determined by the ability and the tact of the interviewer rather than by the quality of the questions posed. The questions they have written, but the way you ask them, the way you pose your question, that is an art, that is important. Because the interviewer himself poses the questions and notes down the answers by himself, the quality of questions has not got any great significance. Okay, so here art of interviewer is important in schedule. Schedule is the name usually applied to set of questions which are asked and filled by an interviewer in a face to face situation with another interviewee. Okay, this the definition is given by Goodenhart. Then by a schedule, we cannot, however, obtain information about many things at once. It is best suited to the study of a single item thoroughly. When you want to focus only on one type of detail, then a schedule is important. Wherein you are using questionnaire, but you are asking the questions by yourself. So you are giving it time. You are using resources, right? So see to it that not many things are involved in your questionnaire. According to Thomas Carson McCormick, the schedule is nothing more than a list of questions which it seems necessary to test the hypothesis. Okay, only a list of questions is there in a form of schedule. In schedule method, interview occupies a central and plays a vital role. Questionnaire is there, but the way the interview has been carried out, the way the questions have been asked, the way the answers have been received, that is important and that plays a vital role. So what are the important features, okay, of schedule? Schedule is presented by the interviewer, the questions are asked and the answers are noted down by him, right? As I said previously also, the list of questions is a mere formal document. It need not be attractive because all the skills are of the interviewer, not of the document. The schedule can be used in a very narrow sphere of social research. As I said, the schedule is mostly used when only one theme has to be taken care of. It aids to delimit the scope of the study and to concentrate essential to the analysis. Again, your scope of the study is limited. Okay, and you have to consider only on some elements that is essential for analysis. It aims at delimiting the subject also. Your questions are fixed. You have to ask these questions, and so the subject also, your respondent also are delimited. In the schedule, the list of questions is pre-planned and noted down formally, and the interview is always armed with the formal document detailing the questions. When you're using a questionnaire and interview, so your questions are fixed. You cannot go out of way of your questions. But when you do your interview schedule, interview session, then your questions are fixed. But you can go haywire and tweak your questions as the responses, what you receive from your respondent. But in this schedule, your questions and the predefined alternatives are already there. So you have to focus on these questions only. What are the points to be kept in mind while designing any schedule? Interviewer should not frame long, complex, defective questions. Some points will be similar to the questionnaire girls. Unrelated and unnecessary questions should not be asked. Schedule should not contain personal and upsetting questions. Okay. Its questions should be simple, clear, and relevant to the topic. They should be suitable to respondents' intelligence level. Impersonal, indirect, and unambiguous questions should be included in schedule. So indirect questions, then unambiguous questions, should not be included in the schedule. Not has been missed. Then what are the merits of schedule? There are merits also, there are advantages also. Higher percentage responses you get through schedule. Possible to observe personality factors. Through interview, personal contact is possible. So it is possible to give human touch to your schedule. Okay, because you are asking the questions. Removal of doubts is possible because face-to-face interaction is there. It is possible to know about the defects of the interviewee. Okay, so through observation, you can get some other information as well. Again, as from schedule, we come to observation techniques. Most commonly used technique of evaluation research is observation. It is used for evaluating cognitive and non-cognitive aspects of a person. Okay, it is used in evaluation performance, interest, attitudes, values towards their life problems and situations. It is most useful technique for evaluating the behaviors of children. So because children will not be able to answer through your questions, also through an interview also. So for any study relevant to children, observation is the best. Technique where you can, it is a technique of evaluation in which behavior observed in a natural situation. It is thorough study that is based on visual observation. Under this technique, group behaviors and social institution problems are also evaluated. This is the definition given by Young. Then observation employs relatively more visual and senses than audio and vocal organs. This is the definition given by Moores. Then the cause and effect relationship and study of events in original form is known as observation. Cause and effect relationship. You come to know about what are the causes and the effect of any event, okay? And you can observe it in original and then write down your points. It seeks to ascertain what people think and do by watching them in action as they express themselves in various situations and activities, right? So you can observe their expressions and what they are doing in that kind of situation, and then you can write down what you have observed. Okay, observe in this. You can also take a video clip and then you can interpret it when you get free time. Okay, you collect all the data first through videos and then you write down whatever is your observation. Observation is recognized as the most direct means of studying people when one is interested in their overt behavior. Okay, whatever according to the situation, what kind of behavior they react, that is more important. Okay, when you want to study the behavioristic characteristics, behavior of the respondent. In questionnaire interview, people may write answers as the thing they do, but this is often different from what they actually do, right? These restrictions are missing in observation, So observation is a more natural way of gathering data. So there is no restriction, because this is conducted in a natural way, natural setting. Okay, naturally you are collecting the data. Artificiality and formality of questionnaires and interview is replaced by reality and informality in observation. Got it? Data obtained through observation are more real and true than the data collected by any other method. Okay, so you get a real picture, true data, and the data what we have collected is actual and informal and real data. It also plays a particular part in survey procedure. Got it? Then what are the characteristics of observation technique? It serves as a formulated research purpose. It is planned systematically rather than occurring haphazardly. It is systematically recorded and related to more general propositions. It is subjected to checks and controls with respect to validity, reliability, and precision. Then observation is a direct technique where you study an object, event, or any problem. And in observation, you can use both visual and audio scenes are used. Okay, you can employ your own experience. Then, as I said earlier also, observation is established through cause and effect relationship. What situation are you going to give them? That is a cause. And what reaction the respondents are giving in that actual settings, that is an effect. Okay, it is an objective technique of data collection, right? Then it is both objective and subjective evaluation technique. Objective and subjective, because this is a natural setting. Whatever you see, whatever you observe is a true picture of the respondent. Okay, so objective and subjective evaluation has been taking place. It is formal as well as informal technique. Okay, the situation what you create is formal, but the reactions what you obtain is informal, right? It is quantitative as well as qualitative technique for data collection. That also you can come out with the observation technique. Then what are the advantages and disadvantages of observation technique? The advantages are it is reliable and valid technique of collecting data and information. We get first-hand data through this method. Record of observation is also available immediately, because when you do the videos, video clipping or audio-visual recording, then immediately you get this record. It is simple, broad and comprehensive method. It is an oldest technique of data collection and getting direct information. But out of advantages, you have limitations also. It has a limited scope for its use because all the events cannot be observed directly, right? It is subjective method. It is very time consuming process, costly, so energy consuming also. So you have to use your resources. Presence of observer influences the behavior of the person. That is, subject becomes conscious. So the setting has to be created in such a way that the respondent doesn't know that someone is observing us. Okay, in case of covert behavior which can't be observed, it is not useful. Observer should be trained and experienced. Okay, then we come to rating scales. Okay, rating is a term that is applied to express opinion or judgment regarding some situation, object or character. Opinions are usually expressed on a scale of values. Rating techniques are devices by which such judgments may be quantified. You have this hedonic scale. Okay, nowadays for everything what you use in online digital digitization, you have a scale. Ola mein ja rahe hai, madam rating de dena, right? So this is rating scales used to evaluate when I am from a test house. So whenever we give our report to the customers, we give them the customer feedback form and we ask them to rate us. Okay, so this is also kind of technique used to collect data about any particular thing. Rating is an essence and direct observation by Ruth Strong. A rating scale ascertains the degree, intensity and frequency of a variable by Von Dalen. The rating is done by who can do the ratings? Parents, teachers, a board of interviewers and judges can even by themselves as well rate about any situation. The special feature of rating scale is that the attitudes are evaluated not on the basis of the opinions of the subjects, but on the basis of the opinions and judgments of the experimenter himself. So the main feature of rating scale is you have to have the opinions of the subjects. Okay, but opinions and judgment of the experimenter himself is also involved in you while using rating scales. Then what are the data rating scales? That means verbal behavior. You can ask them to rate facial expressions, personal documents, clinical type interview, projective techniques, then immediate experiences, that is for emotions, thoughts or perception. Then what are the advantages and disadvantages of rating scale? While writing reports to parents, you can use rating scales. Grades they diye, filling out admission or blank admission blanks for colleges, finding out students' needs. Okay, any so in this is basically survey. In survey, rating scales are used. Making recommendations to employers, supplementing other sources of undertaking about child, stimulating effect upon the race. Okay, then difference in rating abilities, difference in reliability as subjects or for rating, agreement among raters of one type of contact only, average, superior and single, impact of emotions, limits of self-rating, over-rating, then limits of rating of specific qualities and limits of justifications. So there are many limitations also. But in your case, girls, in clinical nutrition analytics, we can ask for any thing. If you are doing any study on pain, you can ask whether it is very painful, less painful, or it is bearable. So you can develop a scale for that also. Okay. So for your also, you can for clinical nutrition analytics also, you can use rating scale as your tool. Then when you collect data, finally, I would like to say, when you collect data, what you must do? You must record your time. Time of the day, date, month or year, when you collected it. That is important, girls. Then total time, number of days or months or years you took to collect that data. It took to collect it along with field note for each response. Your field note. When you are collecting the data, then your observation also should have to be mentioned and kept as a record. Then procedure you forwarded to collect it. What procedure you did. Then average time per respondent or unit. Okay, then experiences you had while collecting it. So all these data are important while you collect data using any of the tools what I have explained. Okay, so thank you very much, girls. From my side, I have done. Any questions?
Ma'am, the questions are in the chat box.
Yeah, please keep it on. Can you please record, ma'am? Kathy is saying, can you please record? Anyone? Sonu, have you recorded?
I am still here. I have done the recording.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is one-to-one interview feasible for 200 children? Kathy, if you have time and you have resources, you can do for 200 children online. Online, then you have to have their parents along with the children. So that you can keep your ask them to keep the video on and you can observe the children as well. It is feasible, but you have to have your resources. Kathy?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
I think go about doing a 7-day dietary recall with 50 plus children online in an efficient way so that you can complete in a quicker way. For 7 days, you have to plan for each children, all the 50 plus children, you have to ask them daily. Daily, you have to define a same slot. जैसे एक बच्चे का आपने 8:30 बजे लिया है next day, तो every day 8:30 बजे आपको उसी बच्चे का लेना है. You have to plan accordingly how many children you can cover in a day. So in that way, you have to plan that for 7 days, you can focus on 20 children or 25 children and next 7 days on another 25 children. So this way you have to do. It is possible, but you have to give a particular time ke half an hour aapko ek bacche ko dena hai because you are asking for children. It depends on what is the age of the children. If the children can answer, well and good, but the children will not be able to recollect what they have eaten for 7 days. Okay, so for children, I will prefer asking them daily, kal tumne kya khaya, kal tumne kya khaya. So I will record it for 7 days. Okay, or you have to teach their mother to record it or to write them in a food diary that what you fed to your children and how much they ate. Got it, Farzin?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Pakhi is saying, what should be the sample size to conduct a pilot study? See, for pilot study, when I did my thesis, Pakhi, I did on around 50 samples to, because my study was a follow-up study for a year. So I have to have confident that whatever data I'm collecting, it has to be reliable and valid. So I did it on 50. For your, I think, for MSc, I think I can go to about 25 to 30 for a pilot study. Okay. Another question by Pakhi, is it okay to use more than one data collection tool? As I said, combination. Please note down, combination research is good. So please use more than one data collection tool for your research. Okay, so you will get authentic results, and whatever data you have interpreted will help you. And my email ID has been given in your presentation. I will share the presentation with Sonu ma'am, and you can mail me if you have any doubts. I will be happy to answer you because you are my girls. I am part of you only. Farzin, again, could you give us a bit more knowledge about KAP? Girls, next session will be on KAP. I will be taking on KAP again. I will prepare a presentation and we will discuss in detail about KAP questionnaire. Okay. Reena has asked, Reena Poptani, in Google form, what is the difference between drop-down box and the multiple choice option? What should we consider? Reena, in drop-down box, only your multiple choice questions are there. See, the respondent will click to the drop-down menu and then your options will be visible. And at that time, the person will select, okay. If you have asked the gender of the respondent, then male, female, other, it will come in drop-down. But male, female, other are your alternative, your multiple choice, right? So this is the way the Google form works.
Actually, in Google form, there are three options. One is checkbox, one is multiple choice, and one is drop down. So that I mean to ask.
But in this is the way you want to portray your questions. If you select checkbox, then your question will be visible and all your alternative will be visible at the same time, and then the respondent have to tick the check. Second option, they have given a drop down.
Neha, I think checkbox is one can click for more than one option in that checkbox menu.
Yes, ma'am. Checkbox is I just had a confusion in drop down and multiple choice. Like multiple choice questions will make the Google form look a bit longer. So yes. Which would be more convenient like that?
Drop down will be more convenient if you want to ask the respondent and only one answer has to be ticked. So for in drop down, your space will be less occupied.
Okay, ma'am. Should we reduce the number of questions in Google form so that
question. That depends on your hypothesis. If you feel okay in your in less number of questions, your answers are relevant to your question, your hypothesis will be answered, then you can do. Okay, but for any question, I think 35 to 40 questions, including your demographic questions. 5 se 7 questions aapke demographic ki ho jate hai. Your name, your religion, your age, from your caste, everything. Education.
Okay.
Some questions are common. But main question relevant to your hypothesis for each, if you have 4 hypotheses, if you have 4 research questions, for each question you will have at least 5 questions. Got it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Welcome. Kathy is asking, does the FAQ consist of all food groups or only the ones we are interested in? Girl, Kathy, is this in this enough? I think you have to include all the food groups. Because see, there are cereals and pulses and protein rich, milk and dairy. So all food groups, and if particular anything you are interested in, if you want to have, okay, fruits and vegetables, yellow and orange fruit color vegetables, that will you can include. Yellow and orange color fruits and vegetables included. When you're working on iron, then you will have green leafy vegetables also. Then you will have consumption of tea and coffee also. Then you will have consumption of vitamin C rich foods also to check the iron bioavailability. So this will depend on what are your research objective. If you have focused on the simple common things, then only the main food groups can be used. But if you want to focus something relevant to, you want to go in deep, like for iron, for zinc, then you have to have their inhibitors, then what are affected, the availability is affected, everything has to be included. Then Park is asking, how can we note the time while using questionnaire online, as we will only receive the responses? See, in this, I think the questionnaire has the time, how much time they have taken to fill the questionnaire. I have not used online questionnaire, so I don't know. I think the time is mentioned. I have just filled and responded to many surveys. So this you will have to check, Paki, whether you can just mention the time they have started filling the form, and then at the last you can ask the time used for writing the questionnaire. Sonu ma'am, can you just comment on this?
Ma'am, submitting time we do get. Whenever they are submitting the form, so we will get in the responses section. Okay. This submitted at maybe 12 a.m. or 12:10 a.m.
But how much time they took to fill the form?
No, I don't think that we get. We need to ask them then.
Yeah, this Paki, you can write a question. Get time required to fill. If last, you get the submission time, then be smart enough and ask the time started. Time you at what time you started filling the questionnaire.
Yeah.
So you will get the submission time, then you can do the calculation.
Yeah.
But Paki.
Okay, ma'am. Yeah.
Then Ruchi is saying, if you are doing a study for some nutrient intake changes during and before COVID, so to collect data for pre and post, do we have to send questionnaire two times or can we conclude in one form itself? It will be better because this is during and before COVID. So here you have to send two questionnaire. You can send it at one time only. But you have to prepare two questionnaire, pre and post. Or in the same questionnaire, you have to have separate sections for before COVID situations and after COVID situations. Because see, COVID has started. So इससे तो कोई मतलब है नहीं कि अभी हम शुरू करेंगे और फिर COVID बाद में आएगा. So in one questionnaire only you can focus. But separate your questions so that the respondent doesn't get confused. Your question has to be clear and simple. Before COVID situations के questions and then after COVID situation के.
Ma'am, but if we include in one questionnaire only, won't the questionnaire be 2 months big for the respondent to fill?
Yes, yes, you can use the same questionnaire, Ruchi, and you can have section 1 and section 2. You can have first section as your demographic details, your characteristics, section B as a before COVID-19 situation, and section C as during COVID.
Okay, ma'am.
And then last section you can have your comments. They can write, you can write, give her 100 words ka unke comments, what is the difference you are feeling, and their suggestions. So that will help you in discussing.
Yes, ma'am.
Ruchi, got it? Ha. So you can divide your question as section A, section B, section C, section D.
Yes, ma'am.
Clear? Any other question, girls? And was this session relevant and helpful to you? I enjoyed this session, girls.
I'm sure it was relevant, really, because I had a discussion with them and asked them. They only suggested like we want a session on data collection tools. So I'm sure they got a brief knowledge about
it. And next time, Sonu, just let me know when we will have this KAP so that I can prepare the PPT and I'll share this PPT. Okay, I'll share this PPT with you.
Yes, ma'am. I had a talk with Pradnya, ma'am. Probably when I think you are free on Saturdays, na?
Yes, Saturday. I'll say, main ghar pe rahke aaram se kar sakti because Monday to Friday my office has started and we are in preparation for our NABL audit.
Yeah, so, we can meet on the coming Saturday, Neha, if you are free.
I am free in the morning time only. We can do because you all are working. Next Saturday is Navratri ki sthapna.
Yeah. So, afternoon 1:30 you want or you want the same time 11:30? I think thoda late afternoon mein we can keep so that that's
chalega. I don't mind. 1:30 is also fine with me. 1:30 to 2:30.
Okay. So I'll just make the brochure and share the details with you.
And girls, you all have an opportunity. Agar aap log KAP pe kuch particular questions hai, then you can mail me immediately so that I will use them and prepare PPT accordingly.
Yeah, girls. Ma'am, I had one question. Ma'am, like if we are giving an NEP, a nutrition education program, and we want to check the impact of NEP, so the questionnaire we give, would it be same the for pre-test and post-test, or would these two be different?
If you are checking for the program and you want to check the knowledge of the respondent, then the questionnaire should be the same.
Okay, the knowledge and practice, if we check, so it would be same.
Example, deti hu. Jaise when I did my study, so what I did collect the baseline characteristics of the, jaise when I give education, so I give education ka training ki aapko ye khilana hai. To pehle unka le liya, FFQ le liya, dietary recall le liya, and then their height, weight, and everything, right? And then post also I use the same FFQ, same dietary recall, and I again check their height, weight, and other measurements. So you can do this way also.
Okay, ma'am.
What did or any other?
Ma'am, can you repeat what you just said?
I said when we do for any education training, right? Education is given for you have to consume this kind of things to keep you healthy, right? So for pre analysis, what you will take? You will take FFQ and a dietary recall. It could be a 1-day dietary recall or a 7-day dietary recall. And if you want to have, if you have the contact with the respondent, you can have the height, weight, BMI according to the age of the respondent. Again, post intervention also, you have to have the same FFQ, same dietary recall, and measurements so that you can compare pre and post. Got it, Farzin?
Yes. So, ma'am, if it is a 7-day dietary recall and a KAP questionnaire, so will the questionnaire be the same? The post
KAP, we will discuss next week. You just mail me a question. I will see to it that I cover your question.
Okay. Thank you.
If you have got your mail ID, you can just repeat. I'll write down on the chat box my mail ID, everyone. I will write my personal mail ID and official mail ID as well.
Girls, for mail me. The KAP sessions, we'll be having it next week completely on KAP. So you guys have any question regarding KAP, you can talk on that day. And today, if you have any other questions for other data collection tools, please feel free to ask ma'am. Or if you get some questions in the coming week, then ask ma'am on Saturday.
Yeah, you can mail me. I have written my mail ID. So you can mail me your queries on KAP and we will discuss on that day.
Okay. Any other question, girls? Yes, no?
No, ma'am.
Okay. No, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Neha. On behalf of
UGC,
I extend my warm thanks to you for joining. I will just share the brochure, Neha, next time for the Saturday's timing. Okay?
Sure.
Thank you, students, for joining. Thank you.
Thank you, students, for your participation.
Thank you, ma'am.